صلى الله عليك يا سيدي يا مولاي يا رسول الله، صلى الله عليك يا أبا عبد الله. يا رحمة الله الواسعة ويا باب نجاة الأمة، يا ليتنا كنا معكم سيدي وسادتي فنفوز فوزا عظيما. قال مولانا أمير المؤمنين علي بن أبي طالب عليه السلام: أنا السر المكنون بين الكاف والنون. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's not a secret that He's created four different kinds of creations: angels, jinn, animal, and insan. Nobody under the sun disagrees that Ahlul Bayt, salamullah subhanahu wa ta'ala alayhim ajma'in, fall under the category of insan. They are humans. And humans by nature have been created limited. Therefore, this makes Ahlul Bayt, salamullah subhanahu wa ta'ala alayhim ajma'in, limited creatures. Yet despite them, salamullah subhanahu wa ta'ala alayhim ajma'in, being limited, they are the most unlimited of the limited that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created. That's why on the 10th of Muharram, we realize that Ahlul Bayt, salamullah subhanahu wa ta'ala alayhim ajma'in, had the power of kun fayakun, be and it will be. Yet they didn't use it. Why didn't Imam al-Husayn, salamullah subhanahu wa ta'ala alayhi, not use the power of be and it will be, despite him having this power in Karbala? Kun fayakun is something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has. That's why within the Holy Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, innama amruhu idha arada shay'an an yaqula lahu kun fayakun. Innama amruhu, it is His command. If He wanted something, if the irada of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called for something, all He needs to say, subhanahu wa ta'ala, be, kun fayakun, and it will be. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given this power to man, primarily Ahlul Bayt, salamullah subhanahu wa ta'ala majma'in. And that's why we'll see in a number of instances they have showed this. And we will allude to this in the upcoming points. Therefore, we want to know, what is kun fayakun? Is it a symptom, or is it a power in itself, or is it a result of something greater? How could we achieve it as human beings? And what is it in essence? We realize this, inshallah subhanahu wa ta'ala, throughout the discussion. Kun fayakun comes from the tree of ism al-a'zam. Ism al-a'zam being something which translated as the greatest name. Now of course, when we speak about names, ulama tell us there are two different kinds of names. There is ism al-lafzi and ism al-khariji, a pronounced name and an external name. A pronounced name, for example, is the word Zayd. I meet a boy, his name is Zayd. This is Zayd. There is no representation of something greater than the term Zayd. There's no apparent, there's no manifest. Zayd is Zayd. It's the term which you see. There's no outside or inside to it. Ism al-khariji, an external name, is a name which represents something greater. It's a manifestation of a bigger meaning. I'll give you an example. The word Al-Aleem of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the all-knowledgeable. This is a ism al-khariji of the word Ilm, which is knowledge. Al-Aleem is the all-knowledgeable because he has something which in essence is knowledge. The essence of that term is knowledge. Or for example, Al-Khabir, the all-knowing. This is an external name of the term Khabar, information. Or for example, Al-Mumit, the one who brings death. This is an external name of the word Maut, death. He has what he has because of the essence that exists, being knowledge, for example, or information coming from Al-Khabir, or the essence, which is death, Al-Mumit. Ism al-A'zam, is it a pronounced name or is it an external name? Because somebody comes and says, I want to attain Ism al-A'zam, because how many stories have we heard of Asif bin Bilkhiya, for example, who was able to bring the queen, were able to bring the throne to Sulaiman alayhi salam before his eye would blink. Ulama come and say Asif bin Barkhiya had only one Ism al-A'zam, yet Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen salamullah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I have all 72 in my chest. I have all of this. That's why the very Imam himself salamullah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he would go to the desert, he would plunge his fist in the sands and he would begin to speak to the ground. A companion would see him doing this. He would tell me, Ya Imam, you do nothing except if there's wisdom in it. Why are you speaking to the ground? He would say, there is knowledge and secrets in this chest. I know nobody to give it to. Therefore, I come to the sands and reveal my knowledge to it. The Imam had all 72. We hear stories. What is this? Is it a code which I can go somewhere and see? Yes, now I have Ism al-A'zam. Is it a secret code name? No. Ulama come and say that this Ism al-A'zam is not a specific name, it's a reality, it's phases. Meaning 72 names in essence are not 72 pronounced names, there are 72 phases, 72 realities. Furthermore, ulama take it to another level. They say each name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could be connected with an act that's taking place in the world. Meaning, to simplify, any action in alim al-imkan, the world of possibilities, the world that we live in, it's a world of possibilities, as ulama refer to it, alim al-imkan. Every act is correlated with one name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For example, if death exists, it's because of the name that Allah exists, al-mumit. Everything goes back to one of these 99 names. Now, of course, we say there are 99 names. Within the Holy Quran, ulama come and say, for example, Allama Tabatabai, rahmatullah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says there's 127 names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala within the Holy Quran. Yet, of course, when you go to Dua Joshan al-Kabir, you see there are nearly 1,000 names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us these names, he gives it to us for a reason. He says, you want something from me, come and ask me through that name. For example, I want sustenance from Allah. I know that sustenance only comes from the sustainer. Thus I'm going to say, Ya Razzaq, Arzuqni. O sustainer, sustain me. Otherwise, if I want wealth from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and I say, Ya Mumit, O the one who brings death, Ya Mudhil, O the one who humiliates, please give me money. What's the correlation between Ya Mumit and somebody wanting money? That's why they say, Ya Mushafi, Ya Mu'afi, Ishfini. O the one who brings Shifa, O the one who brings Afa, meaning well-being, give me, cure me, for example. And this is very practical in our day-to-day lives. When I go to somebody who has a degree in medicine and somebody who also has a degree in engineering, I want to go and receive medicine from him. I'm not going to him with the intention of asking about his abilities, for example, in the world of engineering. I go to him and I tell him, you have 2 degrees, but I have nothing to do with your degree of engineering. I want to see how you can play with your degree of medicine. Cure me. Likewise with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I want, for example, love from him, I'm going to say, Ya Razzaq, Rizuqni. I want, for example, sustenance from him, I'm going to say, Ya Mu'ati, Ya Wasi' al-Na'ma. Right? O the one who is vast in his blessings, give me. Right? Therefore, these 72 in essence, they are not names, they are realities of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why when I say that ulama, they say every act is correlated with something specific. Here a problem arises. Because when we go to the Holy Quran, we'll see that there are certain acts which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says human beings can do. And they're not, it's not necessarily him doing it, it's a human being doing it. I'll give you an example. Musa, ala nabiyyina wa ala alihi wa alayhi salam, he would be one day, he would turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He would say, وَلَمَّا جَاءَ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, first is the Holy Quran, Surah Al-Imran, chapter 3, he says, بِسْمِ اللَّهِ الرَّحْمَنِ الرَّحِيمِ وَلَمَّا جَاءَ مُوسَى لِمِيقَاتِنَا وَكَلَّمَهُ رَبُّهُ Musa alayhi salam comes to meet with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah begins to speak to him. قَالَ رَبِّي أَرَنِي أَنْظُرْ إِلَيْكَ. Oh my Lord, let me see you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala replies to him. He tells him, إِنَّكَ لَنْ تَرَانِي. You will never see me. لَنْ in Arabic means it removes every possible. إِنَّكَ لَنْ, never will you. Not today will you see me. Yesterday you're going to see me. Tomorrow you'll never see me. That's why it's interesting when people say on the Day of Judgment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will have legs and hands and will be walking. One leg would be in Jannah, one leg would be in Jahannam, and we'll be walking in between. It's interesting. We're the one who are referred to as mushrikeen. Huh? He tells him, إِنَّكَ لَنْ تَرَانِي. You will never see me. He tells him, وَلَكِنْ أُنظُرْ إِلَى الْجَبَلِ. Look at that mountain. Allah uses a term within the Holy Quran that solves this idea. Ibrahim alayhi salam, the birds come flying to him. فَادْعُوهُنَّ. They will يَأْتِينَكَ سَعْيَا. When he said, oh Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, رَبِّي أَرِنِي. كَيْفَ تُحْيِي الْمَوْتَى. How do you resurrect the dead? He would tell him, أَوَلَمْ تُؤْمِن. Do you not believe? He said, no, I believe. He says, وَلَكِنْ يَطْمَئِنَّ قَلْبِي. I want my heart to believe it. He said, then take four birds, place each bird on the tip of a corner, four corners, then call on to them, فَادْعُهُنَّ يَأْتِينَكَ سَعْيَا. They would come flocking towards you. Huh? They came to Ibrahim, not to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ibrahim told them to come, meaning they were following the obeys, not of Allah, following the obeys of Ibrahim alayhi salam. Isa alayhi salam resurrects the dead. They listen to the command of Isa alayhi salam. Dawood, he plays with the winds. They were nothing but a toy in his hand. Iron, for example, was melted. وَلَيَّنَّ الْحَدِيدَ لِدَاوُودَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, the iron was melted. Well, these are humans. They're doing it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala isn't doing it. How do we solve this issue? They come, they bring us a term which is known as تَجَلَّى. Manifestation. Verse of Musa alayhi salam. رَبِّي أَرِنِي أَنْظُرْ إِلَيْكَ. My Lord, let me see you. إِنَّكَ لَنْ تَرَانِي. You will never see me yet. Look at that mountain. أَنْظُرْ إِلَى الْجَبَلِ. Musa alayhi salam turns around, he looks at the mountain, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses the same word, tajalla, manifestation. فَلَمَّا تَجَلَّى رَبُّهُ لِلْجَبَلِ. Allah manifested himself in that mountain. Does this mean he saw him physically? No. The verse continues, it says, جَعَلَهُ دَكَّى. The mountain crumbled into pieces. وَخَرَّ مُوسَى صَعِقًا. Musa alayhi salam went down in prostration, instantly he came back. To his senses, he realized Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was sending a message to him. Meaning, Allah manifested himself through the mountain. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala manifested his ability to resurrect the dead through Isa. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala manifested his ability of controlling the winds through Dawood. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala manifested his ability in answering a supplication quickly through Asif bin Barkhiya. That's why, when we speak about this whole notion of Ism al-A'zam, there is nobody who manifests this notion better than Ahlul Bayt, Muhammad wa al-Muhammad, salawatullah subhanahu wa salamu alayhi wa jama'in. Ahlul Bayt alayhi wa salam, salamullah subhanahu wa ta'ala alayhi wa jama'in, they say, نَحْنُ الْأَسْمَاءُ الْحُسْنَى. We are the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Question, what does it mean to say that you are the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Imam Ali alayhi salam, salam Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, comes and says, Anan ismul a'zam. I am the greatest of names. How does that work? Well, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, to him the names belong. فَلِلَّهِ الْأَسْمَاءُ الْحُسْنَى. To Allah, how can you come and say, I am ismul a'zam? I am. Is this an arrogance from the Imam? Really, if you study majority of ahadith of Imam Ali, salam Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he's always saying, I am the Quran. I am the bridge between the earth and the sky. I am the one who will take you to Allah. I am the door. Is this a sense of arrogance? No. It may be an arrogance for anybody else, except for Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam. They're showing their greatness, because despite them showing their greatness, people would come and say, how many hairs do you have in your head? They lived in a difficult situation, because there are some times where the leader is above the nation. Huh? Of course, 12th Imam, Ajallah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Farj al-Sharif, when he comes out, it's going to be the closest distance between the nation and between the leader. That's why the Imam is able to do the government that he had. In the time of the first Imam, salamullah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Christian man comes and says, there are certain people who were born for times other than the times they were born in. And Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen, salamullah subhanahu wa ta'ala, was one of them. in a big distance. He comes and he tells them, Saduni qabla an tafquduni, ask me before you miss me. I am the speakable to Quran. I know the pathways in the sky more than I know the pathways in the earth. One man comes to him and tells him, Ya Imam, how many pieces of hair do I have in my head? There is a big distance. Therefore, when he's saying, I, it's not a sense of arrogance or cockiness. No, no. He's showing them, I am the one who manifested the names. Meaning, if I want to know the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I don't need to refer to anything else but the character of Muhammad, who himself was the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why the man himself, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, comes and he says, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ, Allah in reference to this man, peace be upon his family, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. If I want to know when I see Hassan, I don't see Hassan, I see patience. You want to see patience? Don't forget, he himself was the manifestation of patience. If you see Zahra, salamullah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you're not seeing a lady, you're seeing goodness. There it is, that's goodness manifested within the character of Fatima, salamullah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why the hadith comes and says, لو كان الحسن شخصا لكان فاطمة. If goodness was an individual, it would be Fatima. And like so on and so forth, between all 12 imams, when you see Hussein, you don't see Hussein, you see bravery. When you see Sajjad, you don't see Sajjad, you see obedience. When you see Baqir, you don't see Baqir, you see knowledge. When you see Sadiq, you don't see Sadiq, you see science. When you see Calvin, you don't see Calvin, you see patience. When you see Rida, you don't see Rida, you see satisfaction. When you see Jawad, you don't see Jawad, you see generosity. When you see Hadi, you don't see Hadi, you see guidance. When you see Askari, you don't see Askari, you see hope. And when you see Mahdi, you don't see Mahdi. You see the manifestation of the justice on the earth of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Meaning, all 12 of them, they became nothing but manifestations of the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now it makes sense when the narration of first Imam comes into perspective. What does the Imam say? قال مولانا أمير المؤمنين علي بن أبي طالب صلوات الله سبحانه وتعالى وسلامه عليه. He says, أنا سر المكنون بين الكاف والنون. He says, I'm the hidden treasure between the kaf and the noon. Question, what is kaf and noon? Kun, of what? Kun fayakun. I am the hidden treasure between the kaf of kun and the noon of kun. Meaning, some come and try to explain this deep esoteric narration of our Imam, salamullah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they say the Imam is trying to say, when he says, I'm the treasure between the kaf and the noon, he's saying that the kaf is me, the Imam. The noon is the 12th Imam. I'm the treasure in between, meaning wilaya. Wilaya was the bridge between the first Imam and the 12th Imam. Some take another level. They say the kaf is Adam alayhi salam, and the noon is the 12th Imam, meaning the bridge between the first Prophet, first representative of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on this earth, and the last representative of Allah on this earth. He says, I'm the treasure in between, meaning wilaya. I'm the distance between. Sometimes he says, what is wilaya? How many times have we heard wilaya? Wilaya is the distance between Adam and the 12th Imam. What's the explanation? You'll see all prophets, all imams, came to establish the importance of wilaya. Wilaya, in essence, means what? Authority. Wilaya is a transfer of authority from one person to another. You know what they say, Adam alayhi salam? One of the first, they say one day, Adam alayhi salam would be standing in paradise and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would come to him. He would say, Ya Adam, were it not for two individuals, I would not have created you. He would say, Oh Allah, who are they? He would say, the first one is Muhammad and the second one is Ali ibn Abi Talib, salawatullah subhanahu wa ta'ala wa salamu alayhi. Why does the existence of Adam depend on these two individuals? Why have prophets come? You look at each prophet, For example, would cry about Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam. What does Ibrahim have to do with Hussein? Adam alayhi salam, what does he have to do with Ali ibn Abi Talib? I'll give you some examples. Ismail ibn Hasqil, prophet of Bani Israel, They say Bani Israel would come, they would torture him to such an extent, they would take the skin from his face and they would pull it off. They would rip the skin off his face. He would be in a very painful situation. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would send Jibra'il to him. Jibra'il would come. He would say, "Oh Ismail, do you need any help?" He would say, "You know what? No, 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 leave me. I like this feeling. Skin off your face, you like it?" He would say, "Yeah." "Why?" He would say, "Li uswatun bil Husayn ibn Ali." He would say, "I have an example in Husayn, son of Ali." Meaning, I know there's a man who would come 1400 years or more than that down the line who would feel the pain more than me. Therefore, I want to feel some of the pain knowing that I won't be there with him. You look at Adam alayhi salam, when the verse comes, it says, وَعَلَّمَ آدَمِ الْأَسْمَاءَ كُلَّهَا. He taught Adam all of the names in Surah Al-Baqarah, chapter 2 of the Holy Quran. Which names? Some come say he taught him the names of the vegetable and the cucumber and the tomato, and he taught him the names of countries. This is Allah, this is the first message he has for Adam alayhi salam. "I'm going to teach you the names of cucumbers and tomatoes." What a great religion we have. No, no, it's more than that. عَلَّمَ آدَمِ الْأَسْمَاءَ. Names. What are the names? One narration comes and tells us. You tell him the first name is Muhammad. Second name is Ali, Fatima, Hassan, Hussein. Fifth name, he'd begin to cry. He would say, "Ya Allah, first four names, I felt jubilant. I felt happy and excited. I felt ecstatic. Fifth name, I feel sad. Why?" He would say, "The fifth name is a man who will be laying on the 10th of Muharram. And he would serve as the most saddest incident that would take place in history." Huh? Prophet of Ibrahim a.s. is walking by. He trips. He begins to bleed. He turns around and says, "Ya Allah, I'm your Khalil. I'm your friend. Why did you do such a thing to me?" He would say, "No, no, 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 no. You haven't done anything wrong. But I want your blood to mix with the blood who on that same exact place where you fell would be a man by the name of Hussein." Meaning, why, brothers and sisters? Ihna, we believe in Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam. Are they simply a family that came after the Prophet, peace be upon his family, or were they something which existence was depending upon, as we've mentioned? Huh? We'll see. Wilaya is that bridge. Because when we say that Imam Ali alayhi as-salam, was the founder of Wilaya, we always mention these kinds of Wilaya of Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi as-salam. The reason why we say wilayah of Ali ibn Abi Talib, even though he was the last individual to receive this wilayah upon its completion, the reason why we say he is the one who completed it was because it ended with him. Otherwise, wilayah didn't begin with Ali ibn Abi Talib. It simply was completed by Imam Ali alayhi salam. I'll give an example of what a poet says. The poet comes and says, "Wilayah was initiated when the angels went down. And it was completed when the hand went up." What is he saying? Angels went down when? Adam alayhi salam. Hand went up when? 18th of Dhul Hujjah. Meaning wilayah is something that Adam alayhi salam initiated. Look at what our, and it was not completed by our first imam. Eighth imam, Imam Ridha, salamullah subhanahu wa ta'ala alayhi. He says that the similitude of those who accepted the bay'ah of Imam Ali salam Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are the same as those who prostrated down to Adam alayhi salam. And the similitude of those who moved away from the bay'ah of Imam Ali alayhi salam is the similitude of those who did not accept to prostrate down to Adam alayhi salam. There's a depth to it. Those who prostrated down to Adam alayhi salam were who? The angels. Those who said, "We don't want to give bay'ah to Adam alayhi salam." Huh? "Ana khayrun min khalaqtani min nar wa khalaqtuhu min tin." I'm better than him. Shaytan, la'natullah subhanahu wa ta'ala alayhi. Meaning, the line between good and evil was that line of wilayah. The distance between haqq and batil was that line of wilayah. The distance between angels and shaytan was that line of wilayah. Meaning, wilayah isn't just something secondary. It's the distance, it's the dichotomy, it's the polarizing factor between good and evil. Huh? Therefore, when we come to the Holy Quran, does the Quran allude to wilayah, which is the distance which bridges the gap between all of the prophets? It's the bandage of the message. Huh? It's the rubber band of all of the sticks. Huh? You can have the best sticks. If you don't have a rubber band, it's not going to keep them together. It's what keeps them, it's the glue of the message. Huh? It's the juice of Islam. Huh? Does Quran speak about it? Or is it just something which narration speak about it? No. Within the Holy Quran, brothers and sisters, there are two verses which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses to establish wilayah. Firstly, he gives us one to establish it And he gives us a second one to clarify it. Why? Just give me one to establish it. Why give me one to clarify it? No. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows there's going to come people after time who are going to try to amend verses within the Quran. Because Christians fell in this trap. You'll see today how many versions of the Bible do we have. Jews fell in this gap, fell in this trap. How many versions of the Torah do we have today? No religion has the same book which fell on their prophet except for you and I. That is an honor. Because when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes and says, إِنَّا نَحْنُ نَزَّلْنَا الذِّكْرِ وَإِنَّا لَهُ لَحَافِظُونَ, we have brought it down, we will protect it. Allah knows that there's going to be people who are going to try to amend. Quran, they weren't able to mess around with it. Huh? They can't change the text. Therefore, they try to change what? The meaning. Therefore, you'll see some verses of the Quran. عَبَسَ وَتَوَلَّى, he frowned and turned away. In parentheses, the Prophet. Zain Habibi, with all due respect, who told you that the Prophet frowned and turned away? No. It's called parenthetical mistranslation. They can't change the verses. So what are they going to do? Try to put some parentheses here and there that support their views. They can't change the meaning. They can't change the text. Therefore, they change the meaning. Of course, there are some people who tried to change the text. For example, the Mu'tazila are a glaring example. Mu'tazila, you'll see that they don't believe in the attribute of speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore, when the verse comes and says, وَكَلَّمَ اللَّهُ مُوسَى تَكْلِيمًا, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke to Musa, they alter the verse to what? وَكَلَّمَ اللَّهَ مُوسَى تَكْلِيمًا. Besides the vamma, they put a fatha. Meaning, besides saying Allah spoke to Musa, Musa spoke to Allah. But of course they failed, and they failed miserably, because today you go to the verse and it says, وَكَلَّمَ اللَّهُ مُوسَى تَكْلِيمًا. Therefore, for the majority of the part, they weren't able to change the text. Therefore, they changed the meaning. How did they try to change the meaning study? You'll see many people, he's a Muslim, he comes and tries to change what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying. Because when you see something is different in the Quran, you have two options. Either you change yourself to agree with the Quran, but if you're so arrogant, you'll change the book to agree with you. And people have tried to do this. How? Three different ways. Firstly, verses which raise their individuals, or raise individuals who they don't want to be risen, they take the verse and they give it to their people. Meaning, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raises somebody who they don't want to be seen raised, they take the verse and they give it to their buddies. For example, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. إن تتوبا إلى الله فقد صغت قلوبكما وإن سورة التحريم وإن تظاهرا عليه فإن الله هو مولاه وجبريل وصالح المؤمنين والملائكة بعد ذلك ظاهرا. Allah speaking to two wives of the Prophet. He tells them, إن تتوبا, if you repent, فقد صغت قلوبكما, your hearts will be pure. وإن تظاهرا عليه, if you go against the Prophet, Allah will be your enemy. Jibra'il will be your enemy, and salih al-mu'mineen, and the best of the believers will be your enemy. Clearly, salih al-mu'mineen, in the hadith of our books, and perhaps the books of our brothers, is who? We say Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They come and they say, no, salih al-mu'mineen is a reference to person A and to person B. And who said? Said, I wish it was only in Quran. You go to a hadith, we come and we say, Aliyun ma'al haq wal haq ma'a Ali, truth. Ali is with truth and truth is with Ali. They come and they give us a hadith which comes and says, Fulan is with Haq and Haq is with Fulan. I mean, this man Abu Huraira was really good at what he used to do. You know the prophets that we hear, the narrations? For example, the prophet, there's some narrations which you feel embarrassed to mention, because this same man which was on Khuluqan Azeem, the same man which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes and says, لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ لِمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُ اللَّهُ لِمَنْ آخِرٍ. This great man, exemplary character, is the same man who they come and they describe saying was one day walking with Hudhayfa al-Yamani, Hudhayfa being known as the Katim Asrar Rasul, the protector of the secrets of the Prophet. He would one day be walking and he sees a spath, a thin piece of wood of a city. The Prophet, peace be upon him and his family, the man who reaches the distance of two bone arrows from Sidrat al-Muntaha, the throne of divinity, he goes to the side and he relieves himself. How does he relieve himself? While standing. And then there's another narration which they come and they say, one man comes and says, مَا بُلْتُ قَائِمًا مُنْدُ أَسْلَمْتُ, I have never urinated standing ever since I have become a Muslim. So the Prophet of Islam, who reaches Qaba Qawsain, astaghfirullah, does what he does while he's standing. Yet the Caliph himself, he says, me? No. I have never done such a thing ever since I have become a Muslim. This Abu Huraira, Only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows how much wealth he was given to do what he was doing. The man wanted to sell tomatoes and nobody was buying, therefore he threw a hadith. Buy tomatoes, Jannah is yours. Next day people started to buy tomatoes. Meaning there was a tactic. When we hear these kinds of narrations, what are they? They're nothing but a fabrication of the haq. Therefore, firstly, what they'll try to do, verses which raise individuals, they don't want to be raised, they take them, give it to their individuals. Verses which defame their individuals, what do? They give it to us. Abasa wa tawalla? No, it can't be so and so. It's the Prophet. Who's the Prophet? This is the time we live in. The student is raised over the teacher. The companion is raised over the Prophet. And the killed is placed on the same level of the killer. Do you know what they say when it comes to Yazid and Imam al-Husayn, salamu wa ta'ala alayhi? Sayyiduna Yazid qatala Sayyiduna al-Husayn. Our master Yazid has killed our master Husayn. How are they two masters? Yeah. Today you go and you open, it's found online, you'll go online, you'll see the Mufti sitting down. One lady would call. She would tell him, Grand Mufti, what is this issue of Karbala? We don't hear too much about it. What happened? Is it true? You know, Imam Husayn? When she says Husayn ibn Ali was killed and Yazid was mistaken. Is that the case? Grand Mufti, we're not speaking about some Joe Schmo. No, this is the head of the sect. He comes and he begins to say, Inna bay'ata Yazid bay'atan sharriya akhadaha min abuhu Muawiyah. He says the bay'ah, the oath of Yazid was a legitimate oath. He took it from his father. And then do you know what he says? He says, Qad akhta' al-Husayn. Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam, salam Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, was mistaken. And then he says something very interesting in the end. He says, غَفَرَ اللَّهِ لِلْجَمِيعِ. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive the sins of everybody. Do you know what the irony is? Mufti is asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the forgiveness of Imam al-Husayn, salam Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a man who prophets have asked Allah for forgiveness through. Prophets come and say, oh Allah, through Husayn, forgive me. Yusuf alayhi salam was saved from the world because he asked through Aba Abdullah al-Husayn. Nuh's ark was saved because he asked through Aba Abdullah al-Husayn. Musa alayhi salam didn't drown in the river of the sea because he asked through Aba Abdullah al-Husayn. But Mufti says, oh Allah, forgive Husayn, please. Meaning, this is the time when, therefore, verses which defame their individual, no, sorry, you have all mistaken. It's not all right, it's the Prophet. Therefore, you'll see, Abasa wa tawalla, glaring example. He frowned and turned away. Who? The Prophet, in parenthetical. This parenthetical crime, it's really a crime. Number three, verses which are so clear, they defame, meaning he can't play around with it, he'll come and he'll tell you. No, sorry, you've misunderstood the verse, it's really praising. An example, chapter 9 of the Holy Quran, Surah At-Tawbah, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, إِلَّا تَنْصُرُوهُ فَقَدْ نَصَرُهُ اللَّهُ. If you don't give victory to him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give victory to him. Verse which came into existence when the Prophet of Islam, peace be upon him, would leave Mecca, going to Medina in his hijrah. In that cave, there was a man with him. He heard the hooves of the horses trampling towards the cave. Therefore, he would turn to the Prophet. He would begin to complain. He would say, Ya Rasulullah, they're coming after us. That's it. It's over. Islam is done. He would turn to him. He would say, إِذْ يَقُولُ لِصَاحِبِهِ لَا تَحْزَنْ. Don't fear. He told who? His companion. Our brothers come and they take this verse. And they say, you, oh Shia, oh followers of Ahlul Bayt, you come and you say that the companions don't have an elite status. Ahl bayt salam Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alayhim. You've never come across this verse. إِذْ قَالَ لِصَاحِبِهِ. He told his companion, would the Prophet refer to somebody who you refer to as has done this, this and that? Abians, as صَاحِبِهِ, as his companion. What do we say? We say Yusuf alayhi salam would be sitting down while he's speaking to kuffar, disbelievers in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In the prison cell, he would turn around to them, he would say, Ya sahibay as-sijn, O companions of the jail cell, أَأَرْبَابٌ مُتَخَلَّفُونَ خَيْرٌ أَمِ اللَّهُ الْوَاحِدُ الْقَهَارُ. Is a number of lords better or one lord who we worship? These were kuffar or no? I believe they were kuffar. The verse says, إِذْ يَقُولِ صَاحِبِهِ يَا صَاحِبَي السِّجْنِ. He would teach them tawheed, but he says, O companions of the jail cell. But They come and they say, no, no, no. He's raising him by saying sahib. Well, Yusuf is referring to kufar al-sahib. Huh? Therefore, how does this mean? Therefore, move it a little bit further. What is he telling him? He's telling him, la tahzan, don't fear. If somebody had bravery in his heart and he was given high status, would the Prophet of Islam be telling him, don't fear? Huh? I just ask them, give me one instance where the Prophet of Islam turned to Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib salam Allah ta'ala, and told him, don't fear. Is there any place in history? On the exact contrary. You'll see in Khaybar, Khandaq, Uhud, Siffin, Badr, Nahrawan, Jaman, battle after battle. Even in one battle where Imam Ali alayhi salam wasn't there, companion A would come. He would say, it must be me. He's not here. Sit on the side, Habib. Second person comes. Is it me? Wallahi, sit on the side. He says, where is Ali? Prophet, Ali has an infection in his eye. I don't care. I said, well, bring him to me. They bring Imam Ali alayhi salam. He had an infection in his eye. Do you know what the Prophet would do? He would take some of his saliva. He would rub it on the blessed eye of Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen. Imam comes and says, never did I have better vision than I did on that battle. Huh? What would he do on that day? He would go and he would defeat the very Jews themselves with that eye, which they said, oh Imam, oh Prophet, it's a red eye. He's sick. Prophet comes and says, it doesn't, eye is red, eye is green, eye is orange. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told me to choose him. It's not a matter of pick and choose, you know, what do they call it? It's just playing this game, who we're going to choose. No, 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 it's a matter of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala telling me. That's why on that very day he would say, غَدًا سَأُعْطَ الرَّايَ لِرَجْوًا كَرَّار غَيْر فَرَّار. Tomorrow I'll give this banner to a man who is karrar. He goes to the battlefield. Never does he come back defeated. Who is he? يُحِبُّ اللَّهُ وَيُحِبَّانَ وَاللَّهُ يُحِبُّ. He says Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his Prophet love him, and he loves Allah and the Prophet. Therefore, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us two verses. One which establishes and one which clarifies. First verse he gives us is chapter 4, verse 59 of the Holy Quran, which comes and tells us, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, ati'u allaha wa ati'u ar-rasul wa ulil amri minkum. O you who have believed, pay obedience to Allah and pay obedience to the Prophet and those who have been vested with authority. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us three groups. Ati'u Allah, pay obedience to Allah. وَأَطِعُوا الرَّسُولِ وَأُولِي الْأَمْرِ مِنْكُمْ. Huh? Notice over here Allah uses a very grammatical strategy. He didn't say obey Allah, obey the Prophet, and obey those vested with authority. He put waw, which is known as waw al-irafa. He didn't say obey those vested with authority like he did to obey Allah, obey the Prophet. Why? Because obedience to the Prophet automatically will give you obedience to those who are vested with authority. Meaning there's no gap between the two. Huh? Therefore, who is أُولِي الْأَمْرِ مِنْكُمْ? Could it be the person who came and said, the Prophet says, Mut'az halal, but I say Mut'az haram? Could it be the man who said that the Prophet of Islam prayed with his hands down, but I went to Rome and I was impressed, therefore we're going to cross our hands? Or could it be the man who would say, the Prophet says this, that Fatima salamullah alayha is great, but I'm going to go and crush her ribs? Could it be? Let's see. No, no, no. Can't be the case. It must be somebody who is nothing but a reflection of the Prophet of Islam. Therefore, give me one person in history who slept in the bed of the Prophet when the Prophet would go on hijrah. Give me one person in history who as a child would chase the Prophet, hitting those who would bring praying to the Prophet. Give me one individual who the Prophet would say, me and him are the fathers of this nation. Give me one individual where the Prophet would say, were it not for this individual and Khadija, Islam would not have existed. It's difficult. But upon all of that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us another verse to clarify it. He says, perhaps there are some people who want to play that sick game of theirs. Coming and trying to change and alter and sticking until they have an Islam which isn't the Islam. Today, you look at Wahhabism. Wahhabism, in essence, what is it? It's Islam that they have created, not the Islam of Muhammad. It is Muhammad, but Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab. It's a different Muhammad. Alhamdulillah, we have Muhammad, they have Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab. They've manifested a new Islam. You look at it, Allahu Akbar. We say Allah is one, there's nothing like him. They say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is one, there is something like him. He has legs, he has toes. You can tell them, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Laysa kamithlihi shay, there's nothing like him. We have five toes. How could Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also have a foot? No, no, no. He has five toes, but there may be some toes under his foot, maybe six, seven toes. He comes in and tells you the hand of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will come in your qiyamah. You can tell him, Habibi, honestly, we're not here to debate, but you have, you know, we have five fingers. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also has a hand. No, five fingers. Maybe there's a finger over here. There's a finger. 10, 11, maybe 12 fingers. Yeah, I don't know how that works. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Therefore, you'll see, huh, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala came and He said, one verse establishes it. Second verse clarifies it. So none of this nonsense could take place. And it's interesting, upon all of the efforts of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah just needs to say be and it will be, huh, there's still some confusion and misunderstanding. Yet Allah gives us 459 to what? To plant the flower. 555 comes and waters the flower. What does it come and tell us? Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Innama waliyukum Allahu ورسوله والذين آمنوا الذين يقيمون الصلاة ويؤتون الزكاة وهم راكعون إنما وليكم your ولي same root word of what in the name of وأول أمر منكم in 459 uses the same exact word to send you a message. There's a connection between the two. أول أمر are the same words in 555. 459 is what? It's a bridge. It's a pathway to the destination, which is 555. إنما بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وليكم الله ورسوله والذين آمنوا الذين يقيمون الصلاة. Your ولي are those, the prophet, huh? And those who believe. Allah سبحانه وتعالى, the prophet. Those who believe, oh Allah, please tell me who are the ones who believe. حتى we don't have this confusion in the ummah. So that we don't have people in Pakistan being killed simply because they love Ali ibn Abi Talib. So that we don't have people in Iraq being beheaded simply because his name is Haidar. So that we don't have the sectarian war and dispute within the Muslim ummah. Oh Allah, tell me, who are they? Huh? إِنَّمَا وَلِيُّكُمُ اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. Who are the ones who believe in Allah? الَّذِينَ يُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةِ. Those who establish prayer, وَيُؤْتُونَ الزَّكَاةِ, and give charity while they're in ruku'ah. Today, brothers and sisters, study Bukhari, study Tirmidhi, study Ibn Majah, study Sunan Abi Dawud, study all of the six major kutub of our brothers. You'll see no verse says that the one who gave charity while in ruku'ah was anybody other than Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib, salawatullah subhanahu wa ta'ala wa salamu alayhi. Therefore Allah came and said, I'm going to clarify it, I'm going to establish it, and I'm going to clarify it as well. Therefore, kun fayakun, we return back to this main notion. The distance between it is what? Is the wilaya. Ism al-A'zam is a result of wilaya. Then how important is this wilaya? That's why Imam al-Baqir, salamullah subhanahu wa ta'ala alayhi, comes and tells us, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told man to pay heed to five things: salah, sawm, zakat, hajj, and wilaya. He says the irony is that they placed importance on the first four, but they neglected the fifth, which was the most important one. Because it is the glue of the four other primary tenets in the religion. Therefore, one point which comes across to bring it down to a practical level and not only at a theoretical level, if wilaya is the gap between the kaf and the noon for kun fayakun, between the prophets, between the first imam and the 12th imam, what is the gap between me and kun fayakun? How do I, here in the 21st century, is there a possibility for me to be able to taste the sweetness of these abilities Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us, huh? There's inspiration, for example. Man could receive inspiration. You'll see the companions of Isa alayhi salam receiving inspiration, despite them not being infallibles. Now, for example, you'll see the mother of Musa alayhi salam, فَأَوْحَيْنَا إِلَىٰ أُمِّ مُوسَىٰ, huh? فَأَوْحَيْنَا إِلَىٰ الْحَوَارِيِّينَ. They receive revelation, for goodness sake. The bumblebee receives revelation. وَأَوْحَىٰ رَبُّكَ إِلَىٰ النَّحْلِ. We send revelation to the bumblebee. Likewise, كُن فَيَكُون is not exclusive to infallibles. It's inclusive for even the fallible as well. Kun fayakun is when there is no distance between man and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because we said, Ahl Bayt could do these nice, unbelievable things because there is no gap. I'll give you an example. Imam al-Kadhim, our seventh Imam, salamullah subhanahu wa ta'ala alayhi, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad. He would be one day in the palace of Harun al-Rashid, and Harun would tell him, oh Imam, extend your hand for that piece of bread. He would extend his hand, Imam would say, he would get ready to eat it, Harun would command a magician to zap it. The bread would disappear. Imam al-Kadhim alayhi salam notices everybody's beginning to laugh at him, he becomes furious. Therefore, Imam turns around, he sees what's on these walls, he sees a picture of a lion. He says, "O lion, come out." People begin to laugh. He says, "This man has really lost it." He's talking to pictures on the wall right now. "O lion, come out." Lion comes out. He stands in front of seventh Imam. He tells him, "O Imam, what would you like me to do?" He would say, "Go and eat the magician." Huh? Lion goes. He shreds the magician into pieces. He comes back to him. He tells him, "O Imam, would you like me to do anything else?" He would say, "You want to eat Harun Rashid?" Huh? He tells him, "If you want me to." Harun Rashid begs. He says, "Please, O lion, O Imam, command the lion to spit my magician out." Imam, being the man of rahmah that he is, commands the lion to spit out the magician. He says, "O lion, go back into the picture." It goes back. Somebody comes and says, "This is Bollywood. What is this? This is nonsense. This is something which even puts Hollywood to shame." Huh? Yeah, no. Kun fayakun. There's a difference between mutlaq al-wilayah and wilayat al-mutlaqah. Mutlaq al-wilayah, huh, is when you have absolute authority. Meaning, you have one vitamin. Musa alayhi salam, he wants to split the sea, sea splits. Jesus wants to resurrect the dead, they resurrect. For example, Dawood alayhi salam, he wants to control the winds, he can control them. There's only one vitamin. Wilayat al-mutlaqah is different. It's authority of the absolute, not absolute authority. It's authority of the absolute, meaning kun fayakun. Absolute is nothing but a tool in your hand, huh? You want the lion to come out, he comes out. You want him to walk on water, he walks on water. Meaning kun fayakun is just one of the tools in his arsenal, in his pocket, huh? It's mutlaq, it's reliant on the authority of the absolute, not absolute authority. Now imams have it, yes. How do I have it? I mentioned it's the distance between us and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore, that distance is there. When that distance is removed, then you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are merged, not in a sense of shirk or kufr, but your desire becomes the desire of Allah. Your goal becomes the goal of Allah. There's no clash, there's no confusion, there's no what? There's no gap. How many times? There's a gap between input and output. Oh Allah, give me. Allah doesn't give me. There's a gap between asking and receiving. There's a gap between raising and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sending. There's a gap between making a step and seeing the results. Huh? There's always a gap. You'll see this gap in Chinese movies, for example. Huh? They say something and nearly 15 minutes later you'll hear it. That's a gap. Or for example, you'll come into a masjid, you turn on the light, 20 minutes later, the light turns on. That's a gap. Or sometimes if you have a very bad car, you turn the steering wheel and nearly 5 minutes later, the steering wheel turns. That's a sign of a gap. Now, these are gaps in Chinese. What's the gap between me and God? Oh Allah, how many times did you say in the Quran, اِدْعُونِ يَسْتَجِبْ لَكُمْ. Ask me, I'll answer you. أَقْرَبُ إِلَيْهِ مِنْ حَبْلِ الْوَرِيدِ. Closer to you than jugular vein. You're that close? خُبْ answer my dua for goodness sake. No. There's a gap. What's that gap? One great gap is doubt. Doubt allows us to minimize the potential of Allah. Allah is going to answer it? Impossible. Do you know what Allah says? That doubt in your mind is why I'm not answering you. If you had certainty in me answering you, I would have answered it a while ago. But I deal with you, I see you depending on how you see me. You see me as great, I see you as great. If you want to see the image you have in the eyes of Allah, then ask yourself, what's the image of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in your eyes? It's a reciprocal relationship. The more I see him as great, he says, the more I see you as great. The greater trust you have in me, the greater trust I will have in you. That's why you'll see you have prophets who were able to do more than prophets who came after them. Imams were able to do more than... Why? They're all prophets. Huh? لَا نُفَرِّقُ بَيْنَ أَحَدٍ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, we don't distinguish between them. Yet what's the difference? One had a closer level of trust to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than the one prior to him, or the one previous to him, or the one that came before him. I'll give you an example. Musa alayhi salam has to split the sea with what? What was in his hand? A stick, a rod. Imam Ali alayhi salam doesn't need a rod. He splits the door with his hand. The Prophet of Islam didn't need to use his hand. He split the moon simply by asking for it to be split. Meaning, stick, hand, simply requesting. Why? Because the trust gets higher, higher, higher. The capability becomes higher, higher, and higher. Allah says, I don't trust you because you don't trust me. Haven't we heard that man who would come to Isa alayhi salam and he would say, oh Isa, my work is here and I live here and there's a river in between and I have to go there. It's difficult. I can't take a boat every day. He would say, put this in your pocket and go and walk on water. He would say, Isa, something maybe really must be wrong. Did you have nice breakfast today, huh? Walk on water. He would say, yeah, yeah. Put this paper in your pocket. Go and walk on water. He puts the paper in his pocket. First day, he goes, he steps on the water, he doesn't fall. Takes the second step, doesn't fall. The man can't believe it. He runs to work. Second day, he puts his foot on the water, doesn't fall. Third day, puts his foot on the water, doesn't fall. He walks. Fourth day, the man's walking, he reaches the midway point. He says, what's this paper, huh? Inshallah, I have a paper. He takes out, he doesn't have a napkin, he had a paper. He looks at this paper, he looks at it and it says, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. In the name of Allah, the most gracious, the most merciful. He's like, come on, that's it? What does he do? He throws it. I can't throw this napkin because I need it. He throws the paper. Huh? What happens? He falls in the water. He goes to work drowning. Huh? After that, he goes to Isa alayhi salam, drowning, dripping with water from head to toe. He tells him, oh, Isa, your trick didn't work. You tell him, what, did you do something? He told him, yeah, when I was walking, I said, what's this paper? He said, what did he do? He said, I took it out of my pocket. He said, what else? He said, I saw Bismillah. He said, what did you think? He said, I thought that's it, Bismillah. He said, what happened? He said, I fell in the water. He said, why did I fall? You told me this trick is going to work. You're a prophet. You don't lie, do you? He said, oh man, when you took out the paper, you saw what was written on it, you lost trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala lost trust in you. Meaning, it's a mutual relationship. It's a reciprocal relationship. Allah says, remember me, and I'll remember you. اذكروني اذكركم. Huh? That's why, brothers and sisters, when we go to Karbala, we see, did Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam use kun fayakun? Huh? Because he did. If he had it, he would have used it. Many youth come and say, Abu Fadl al-Abbas alayhi salam, he had this power. He could have just asked Allah. Huh? Oh Allah, get rid of, for example, the one who is coming to cut my arm. Oh Imam, oh Allah, get rid of Shimr. Why? Why didn't they just simply raise their hand and ask? Did they? In many instances, they did. Two times in Karbala, Imam Hussein alayhi salam used kun fayakun. One example, for example, Abdullah ibn Hawza would come to Imam Hussein alayhi salam. He would say, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein. He would say, Mada turid, what do you want? He would say, Ibshar bin Nar. Be happy because hell is yours. He would say, Me, Ibshar bin Nar? He's like, Ibshar bi Rabbin Rahim wa Ghafoor. He would say, I have glad tidings of a merciful and a great Lord, not the Lord that you have in your mind, this vindictive Lord. Instantly, Imam Hussein alayhi salam would say, oh Allah, take his life. You know what would happen to the man? He would go back on his camel, he'd begin to ride, the camel trips, or the horse trips, his head, his legs would get attached to the horse, his head would begin to hit palm tree after palm tree until he would die. Huh? First instance. Second instance, a man comes to Imam Hussein alayhi salam. He would tell him, Ya Hussein, do you see Farad? See it glistening? Nice, crisp water? He would say, yeah, I see it. He would say, you'll never drink it until you die. Do you know what the Imam would do? He'd raise his hands. He would say, Allahumma amithu atshana. He would say, oh Allah, let him die thirsty. Do you know how that man died? They'd bring him water, he'd drink it, it'd come out from his nose. He'd drink the second cup, come out from his nose, until the man died thirsty. Yet Imams, they had the ability. Yet they didn't use it for the most part to show you. I, Zainab, daughter of Ali ibn Abi Talib, salamullah subhanahu wa ta'ala alayhi, have people coming trying to rip my hijab and I didn't use this power and I stayed patient. What do you lose your patience about? Huh? I, Hussein, had a sword on my neck, getting ready to decapitate it. I didn't say, Ya Allah, stop him now. I never lost my patience. What do you lose your patience about? They didn't want to make it some Hollywood story of zapping and causing people to disappear. No, no, no. He wanted it to be a practical story. Huh? Never did they use kun fayakun when the earrings were ripped off the ears of Sukaina. Huh? They didn't use it. They didn't use kun fayakun when, do you know what happened? When the whips would come on the legs of Ruqayya alayhi salam. They didn't use it. If there was an instance where they should have used it and they didn't, which shows to us how practical they want this battle to be, was when Sukaina would go to Shimr asking him back for her hijab. Do you know what he would do? He would slap her on the cheek. Huh? Ruqayya would go back and cry. She would say, us the daughters of Nubuwwah, this is what they do to us. But they still didn't use it. Why? To say, we kept our patience. Do you keep yours? Huh? On these nights, we go to what happened to Zainab alayhi salam. Huh? They say that one day a man saw the 12th Imam in his dream. And he told him, Ya Imam, you mention in Ziyarat al-Nahiya that you will cry upon somebody day and night. And besides shedding tears of normal tears, you would shed tears of blood. Who are you referring to in the ziyarah? Are you speaking about the tragedy of Qasim? Imam would tell him, no, if Qasim was here, he would be crying as well. He would say, are you referring to the tragedy of Abbas? He said, no, if Abbas was here, he would be crying as well. He would say, are you referring to the tragedy of Al-Akbar? He said, no, even if Al-Akbar was here, he would be crying as well. He said, Ya Imam, you must be referring to the tragedy of Hussein. He said, no, even if Al-Hussein was here, he would be crying as well. He would say, Ya Imam, who do you refer to when you say, I will cry tears of blood upon this tragedy? He told him, Ya, that two words only he mentioned. He said, Ammati Zayna, ya, ya, I cry upon my own Zainab. You know, every imam, they say, Sama innah, when they're in the worst of situations, they would connect it to Karbala, and specifically to Zainab alayhi salam. That's why they say, Imam al-Sadiq, salamullah subhanahu wa ta'ala alayhi, was one day in his house, when they came and burnt it. Imam would come out of the house running, removing the fire from his clothes, while he was crying. They would tell him, oh Imam, why do you cry? You Ahl al-Bayt are used to martyrdom and death is your dignity. He would say, I cry because when I saw my daughters running from room to room, I remembered my aunts running from tent to tent in Karbala. Do you know what else he must have remembered? He must have remembered when Zainab entered Sham. Do you know they say when Zainab entered Sham in Kulthum, they saw a lady on the throne. She would turn to Umm Kulthum. She would say, oh, Umm Kulthum, do you know that lady? She would say, no, who is that? She would say, that is Hind. Hind was a servant in the house of Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam. Yet when Muawiyah heard there was a lady by the name of Hind in the house of the Imam, he took her and got her married to Yazid. Hind leaves Sham, she leaves Karbala, she has nothing, no knowledge about what happened to Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam. That's why they say Zainab salamullahi alayha enter Sham. She would say, do you know that? She would say, who is it? She would say, that is Hind. Zainab passes by the throne of Hind. Hind asks her, oh ladies, where do you come from? Zainab salamullahi alayha would reply, saying, we come from Karbala, but originally from Medina. And when she heard the name of Medina, she came down from her throne. Zainab would ask her, why did you come down when you heard the name Medina? She would say, because of the respect I have for the people in Medina. She told her, who do you know in Medina? She would say, I know Hussein, I know Zainab. She would tell her, do you know anything about these names? She would tell her, Ya Hind. Now she knows that Zainab knows her name. She wants to know, who is this lady that knows her name? She would say, Ya Hind. saying, if you ask me about Hussein, then go and find his head in Mecca, instead of your husband. She would say, Allahu Akbar, my husband did this. She would say, tell me what happened to Zainab. She didn't recognize this was Zainab. She would say, Ya Hind, if you ask me about Zainab, I am Zainab, daughter of Ali. They say that Hind would take a rock, she would bash it upon her head, she would fall unconscious. When she would get up, her hijab would fall, she would enter the palace. She would say, Ya Yazid, how could you do such a thing to the daughters of the Prophet? You know, as he would tell him, he would say, oh Hind, put the hijab on your head. Hind would say, you want the hijab to be on my head? When the daughters of Muhammad are left without any حجاب اللهم يسر على زينب والله بالإيس لهذا زينب. إنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون. لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. اللهم نسألك بعطش الحسين وبغربة الحسين. Oh Allah, we ask you by the thirst of Imam al-Hussein. Oh Allah, we ask you by Imam al-Hussein when he became a stranger. بغربة الحسين عليه السلام إلا قضيت لنا حوائجنا. Except if you answer our dua, Ya Allah. Oh Allah, prophets have asked you through Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam. We also ask you through him, so do not leave our du'as unanswered. Oh Allah, make us ones who understand wilaya. Oh Allah, make us one who bridge the gap between you and us, Ya Allah. Oh Allah, make us one who make you a part of our lives, Ya Allah. بحق محمد وآل محمد. We recite Amma Yujib 5 times with the loudest of your voices. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Amma Yujib al مضطر إذا دعا ويكشف السوء أمن. أمن يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء. أمن يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء. One more time. أمن يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء. يا كاشف السوء اكشف السوء عنا يا الله. اللهم شافي كل مريض بحق مريض كربلاء زين العابدين. اللهم انصر الإسلام والمسلمين واخذل الكفر والمنافقين. اللهم عجل لوليك الفرج واجعلنا من أنصاره وأعوانه والمستشهدين بين يديه برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. This is the last night, brothers and sisters. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you all for putting these majalis together. And we do know that there was that procession today. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept all those who have walked despite the difficult weather, as I believe it was raining. And hopefully, inshallah, the energy continues from the side of the community in doing more programs. May Allah give them more energy and more tawfiq to do these kinds of gatherings which do nothing except propagate and instill the love of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam even further in our hearts. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us all to be ones who, if not are of the soldiers of the Imam, then are at least of the ones who are serving him once he comes. بحق محمد وآل محمد. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept this majlis and to accept the efforts of all those who have put this majlis together and attended with a Surah Al-Mubarakat Al-Fatiha, but before it, a salawat ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Oh.